Good evening, and welcome to tonight's amazing event. Usually I get to be the bearer of bad news to my fifth grade students when I hand out homework. And so I want to not only thank the university here for putting in overflows and stuff like that, but I also want to take a second to apologize that we did not have a theater to hold the crowd that we have had here. But that just really shows how important this once-in-a-lifetime opportunity is. So again, thank you for coming tonight, but also too, I apologize for any inconvenience. Before we get started, I'd like to take a moment to acknowledge any of our veterans that are here tonight in this auditorium, in the overflows over there and upstairs. If you'd please stand so that we can acknowledge your service. It's because of you that I get to do what I love, and that's being a teacher and also working at Young's Pharmacy. That's not a plug for Young's Pharmacy, but you can always go there. But we are truly lucky to have Kim Roller and Richard Thielen, who have traveled all the way from Seattle, Washington, and Lansing, Michigan, to be with us today for this special opportunity. Because time is running out to hear stories from those that served and from our World War II veterans. When having this idea to talk to businesses, groups, and organizations promoting this project, I told them it was simple math. On July 30th, 1945, roughly 1,200 men were on the USS Indianapolis, coming back from delivering the parts of the atomic bomb when it was torpedoed by a Japanese sub. An estimated 300 men were killed on impact, and close to 900 sailors were thrown into the Pacific Ocean, where they were there and remained unknown to the Navy for 4 days and 5 nights. Struggling to survive, fighting off hypothermia, mental and physical exhaustion, and even shark attacks, all but 316 survived and were rescued. As of today, 14 of those survivors are still alive. And here tonight, we have one, Mr. Richard Thielen. As in school, I give homework and assignments, and I have an assignment for all of you. By being here tonight, you have the responsibility of keeping his legacy and those who were lost at sea alive for years and generations to come in central Wisconsin. I have looked in all our textbooks, and I cannot find a single mention of the USS Indianapolis, the sinking, and or the tragic events that followed. So like I said, this is a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to have Kim Roller and Richard Thielen here with us tonight to bring our education and our history to life. Kim Roller lives in Seattle, Washington, and is an honorary USS Indianapolis survivor. She is a spokesperson for the ship and an official press contact. When she is not flying around the country doing multimedia presentations with indie survivors, she is a flight attendant for Alaska Airlines. She has been dressing up in her World War II era vintage apparel and doing these presentations since 2004. Also, as I have mentioned, we have survivor and World War II veteran, Richard Dick Thielen.
He was only 17 years old in 1944 when he asked his father to sign for him so he could legally join the U.S. Navy. Dick's father agreed, but only if Dick promised to come home after the war. That promise to his dad was the reason for living, for not giving up, when giving up would have been much easier to do. His military rank was S2, Seaman Second Class. And after the war, and after his service, Mr. Thielen went on to finish high school and was honorably discharged from the Navy, which then he ended up being a truck driver for more than 44 years and also raising a family of 6 children. He is joined here tonight with his son, David, also from Lansing, Michigan. Please join me in giving our guests a round of applause.
First off, I want to apologize also for my voice. As I was doing the presentation last night at the school, my voice kept getting lower and sexier. This morning I woke up and it was gone. So I called my doctor at 6 o'clock in the morning and I said, I have to speak twice today. I need something. So he called in a prescription. Has not made any difference. I went down in the lobby of the hotel this morning and met up with Dick and Dave. The first thing I said was, oh, you guys, I've lost my voice. And Dick goes, well, that's a reason to celebrate. Oh, I love my Indy family. My name is Kim Roller, and like he said, I am from Seattle, Washington. I want to thank you guys for letting us come out today, putting up with my croaky voice. I'm going to get through this, and it'll probably work just fine tomorrow. You have a beautiful area. I just want to tell you, as we came in on approach, I see a lot of approaches being a flight attendant. It is a gorgeous, gorgeous area you live here. I've never been in this part of the state. I've been down south. I went and spent some time with one of the last Marines from the USS Indianapolis, Mel Jacob, just shortly before he passed away. Bob Witzig lives just south too. He was unable to be here tonight. But we do have Dick Thielen. So lucky you, because you are in for a treat. You behave. Okay. So we're going to start right out. The first question I always ask of my audience is, when did America, and Mitchell, you were here last night, anybody else who was here last night cannot answer this. When did America enter World War II? Throw it out. December 7th, 1941. What happened? This is Pearl Harbor. 8 o'clock in the morning, Pearl Harbor, Hawaii, the Empire of Japan attacked us. Shortly after 8 o'clock in the morning, guys were still sleeping, guys were just getting up. This is a photograph of the USS West Virginia here, taking all the hits for the USS Tennessee, which did not sink, the West Virginia did. This is a rescue boat, and there's a young man they're trying to save in the water right there. This is what brought us into World War II. Even though World War II had been raging for 2 years over in Europe with who? Germany, exactly. And they were allies with Japan. Well, now Japan has attacked us and brought us in. Tim, can you turn the lights off of Dick? They want to be in the dark during this. We like to keep him in the dark in more ways than one. Okay. So we're now involved in World War II. So things heat up and the war progresses. But we're gonna fast forward a few years to 1945, and we're gonna discuss this ship right here. The USS Indianapolis, CA-35. It was a heavy cruiser for the US Navy treaty. It was a treaty cruiser made in 1932, commissioned 1932. And the year that we're dealing with is 1945, now the very last year of the war. On March 31st, so just a warning, whoever came last night, this is gonna be a little bit different of a presentation. I'm going to go a little bit more in depth than we have. Dick is going to probably tell some dirtier jokes. And we're going to really get into this. So when we get into the question and answer, just be thinking what you want to do, because this is going to be a great, great performance being the last one. So 1945, March 31st, it's the day before the invasion of Okinawa. And Indianapolis is off the shore of Okinawa, shelling it, getting the island ready for the men to go on. And there happens to be, in full force, kamikaze attacks. Does everybody know what kamikazes are? What are they? Suicide airplanes, that's right. The pilot knows when he takes off, he will not be coming back. He is a flying bomb, and he targets whatever he can get, preferably a ship. Well, on March 31st, it was Indy's unlucky day, and there was a Japanese Zero that came straight in and hit her. Well, as he hit, he released a bomb that went down a few decks and ended up killing 9 of the crew members of the USS Indianapolis and damaged her enough to where she had to go back, limp her way back to the United States to Mare Island, California, which is just in the Bay Area right there, just north of Oakland. So she was there for repairs. While she was being repaired, the guys happily got a 30-day leave. So they took off for points everywhere in the U.S. to go see their loved ones, and some of their wives came to them. They knew that the war was winding down. Germany had already surrendered, and they knew that Japan was losing. So a lot of them thought, oh, I'm going to take this 30-day leave, and the war's going to be over. But what happened during this time when they were in California was the U.S. government decided to assign Indy a special mission. At the head of this was the captain of the ship, Charles Butler McVeigh. He had a long lineage of Navy service through his father and his grandfather. He was well-loved by his crew, respected by his peers, and trusted by his superiors to the point where they entrusted him on this top-secret mission like no other ever. What they brought on board his ship in Mare Island, without telling him what it was this thing. Anybody recognize that? Little boy, that's right. The world's first atomic bomb, correct. So they brought on board a big wooden crate that was about 5 feet wide, 15 feet long, and they lashed it down to the quarter deck on Indy, and they put 2 Marine armed guards on it 24 hours a day with orders to shoot if anybody approached it. There were 39 Marines on board Indy, and the Marines are the military contingent. They take care of the naughty ones. And so they were guarding this thing. Also brought on board was a big black canister, and it was brought into one of the officers' cabins and welded down there. Captain McVeigh was told with that canister that if anything should happen to the ship on this top secret voyage, and if it's gonna go down, they are to get a lifeboat for that canister before any of the sailors. Still didn't know what it was. So he is told to take this thing to the island of Tinian, which is in the Marianas chain, and drop it off there. He's told to do it as fast as he can because every hour that he saves in that trip, he's told it's going to shorten the war by that much. Go ahead. He gets to Tinian and unloads it, and this big, beautiful B-29 Super Foresters is there. And who's that man down there? Paul Timmons, that's correct. He's the pilot, he's 29 years old. He's been doing bombing runs and practices in Wendover, Utah. If you ever get the chance to go over there and see the old air base, it's pretty run down. But the Enola Gay hangar is still there, it's gigantic. So he gets to put this bomb on his B-29 and his crew on August 6th, takes it over Hiroshima, Japan. Shortly after 8 o'clock in the morning for them, the world changes and we are brought into the atomic age. They drop that bomb on Hiroshima. This is actually a photograph of the second bomb, which was dropped in Nagasaki 3 days later when Japan did not surrender. Go ahead. This is a photograph of Hiroshima. It was a very vibrant, very alive city, very crowded. One bomb later, that's what it looked like. So this happened, and Japan goes, whoa. But they didn't surrender. 3 days later, we dropped the second one. This is Nagasaki. And if you can see in this black and white photo, this was a very unlucky man, another very unlucky person, who were killed right where they stood. When that second one was dropped by Boxcar, which was the name of the other airplane, Japan knew they could not fight whatever this was, and they surrendered. So the war was over because of these two weapons and Indy's top secret mission. If they had had to invade, which is what the plan was, the United States had already pre-ordered 1 million body bags. They figured it was going to be a bloodbath because Japan was arming their citizens. Most of their men were off at war, you know, but they were arming their children. They were teaching their children how to bayonet in school. They were teaching their children and their elderly how to pull the pin on a grenade if a soldier got close enough to you, that you would blow yourself up, but also kill the soldier. And they were also taught not to surrender. They could kill themselves before they surrendered. It was going to be holy hell. So when Indianapolis left on July 16, 1945, which is also the day that the first atomic test explosion was done at the Trinity Test Site in New Mexico, she took off. She made a speed run to Pearl Harbor, fastest ever done. The record still stands today. They stopped off for a few hours, kept on going across the Pacific Ocean, and made it here to Tinian Island. They dropped off the atomic bomb, still not knowing what they had. Funny thing is when they were making this run and they had this bomb on board, you know, they couldn't approach it, but they could sure talk about it to each other. And they were kind of going, what do you think it is? What do you think it is? Oh, it's Betty Grable. You got Betty Grable in there. One of the guys said, nah, I think it's scented toilet paper for MacArthur. You know, they didn't know what it was. They had no idea what the atomic was. So anyway, they took it and they dropped it off in Tinian, and they proceeded directly south to the island of Guam. And it was there that McVeigh received his next routing orders. He was to go from Guam over here to Leyte Gulf in the Philippines. He was to go on what was called Route Petty. At that point, he requested an escort, a destroyer escort. Now, Indy was not equipped with sonar. Does anybody know what sonar does? What does it detect with those sound waves? That's right, submarines. Indy had no way of knowing if there was a submarine nearby or not. So it was common practice to send another ship along with you that did have sonar. Well, when he requested this, he was denied. And he was told he did not need it along this route. You were safe. So now we're going to go into a little deeper than we did last night. The military knew that there were submarines operating in that area. The USS Underhill had been sunk on that very route 4 days earlier at a great loss of life. They did not tell Captain McVeigh about this because we had cracked the Japanese code. We did not want them to know that we had cracked the code. So they decided that there was a certain level of intelligence that could come down, but Captain was not high enough in rank to receive that intelligence. So he sailed off blind, not knowing. The other part of his order was that he was to zigzag at his discretion, literally zig and zag and zig and zag. The thinking at the time during World War II was that this was an evasive maneuver. If you were going along and maybe doing a turn when a torpedo came after you, you know, you're kind of edging out, but you're a big, huge, lumbering ship. This is a fast-moving torpedo, and the majority of ships in World War II that were sunk were zigzagging. It didn't make a difference. But those were his orders. The words at his discretion meant that if the weather was bad, if visibility was poor, like really bad weather, you know, cloud cover, you don't have to zigzag. You can just go in a straight line because that is the fastest way to get anywhere. It's just go from A to B. Well, on July 29th, 1945, about 10 p.m., Captain McVeigh walks around the ship, takes an assessment of everything. Everything's fine. But the clouds have come over and it is dark. It is really dark. The men talked about not being able to see in their own hands in front of their face. If somebody approached them, they had to call out and identify because they couldn't see them until they got right upon them. That's how thick the cloud cover got. Well, that's great because now we can just go straight. And Captain said, cease zigzagging. Wake me if anything changes. And he retired for the night to his cabin. So he's down there asleep. And about 2 hours later, in that same vicinity, unbeknownst to them and unbeknownst to the I-58 submarine from Kure, Japan. This submarine surfaces, not knowing that Indy's there, raises its periscope, and takes a look around. At that very moment, the clouds part, and the moon lights the USS Indianapolis right up. The man that was in charge of this submarine, of the I-58, is a man named Motsushira Hashimoto. He had been in charge of this submarine for 4 years. He'd been in the war the whole entire time. He had yet to have a kill. He knew his country was losing. He knew the war was going to be over and they were going to lose. But he still wanted to contribute. He wanted to be part of something when it was all said and done, even if they didn't succeed. So when he saw the USS Indianapolis through that periscope, he got real excited. And he repositioned and he fired off 6 torpedoes in a fan shape. One went here, one went here, one went here. And 2 of them connected. The first one, just shortly after midnight, hit right here and completely ripped the bow off. When I say ripped the bow off, this front end did not exist anymore. A few seconds later, the second one hit right here, starboard side midship, right in the ammunition storage. And the ship started to explode. It also opened up a big storage of bunker oil. Does anybody know what bunker oil is? It's a real sticky, thick, horrible substance that came out in thousands of gallons in the ocean. And as the men were being blown off of the ship or jumping off of the ship, a lot of them landed in this bunker oil and it got into their nose and their mouth, made them vomit. It was pretty horrible, sticky stuff. And it coated the whole area. Now, Indy was traveling along at 17 knots that night in what was called condition yoke modified. It was hot in the South Pacific. So they had everything open underneath the ship, every doorway, every hatch, everything, just to get some airflow. And the majority of the men who were sleeping, who weren't on watch at that moment, were sleeping topside because it was so hot underneath. It was like an oven. So these men are up there, and the ship literally is getting blown apart. She's still going ahead at 17 knots with that condition yoke modified open as she just takes in water like crazy and starts to list and starts to sink. Now, if you've seen the movie Titanic, raise your hand. All right, that was a pretty big sinking. How long did it take for that ship to sink? Over 2 hours, 2 hours and 40 minutes. The USS Indianapolis, in all her glory, was 610 feet long, 133 feet tall. How long did it take for her to sink? 12 minutes. That's right. First impact to no ship above water anymore. Their home was gone in 12 minutes. She had been accidentally overloaded in Mare Island with a contingent of life vests. These life vests were made of a fiber, a tree fiber called kapok. So a lot of the men were able to get the life vests if they were near, you know, one of the storage areas. So they grabbed those and they got off as fast as they can. They had very little time, so very few of the life rafts got off of Indy. They also had what were called floater nets that I'll talk about a little bit later. A few of those got off. But the majority of the men were in these kapok life jackets. And this tree fiber that they used at the time was rated to float, to be buoyant, between 48 and 72 hours. Okay, so they had, you know, which is fine because they are due in Leyte on Tuesday and they're gonna get picked up before that, so no big deal. So they are in the water now, it's nighttime, they're hearing each other scream, they're trying to find each other, it's dark. And then as the sun comes up, they notice somebody else is there with them, because they're eating the dead bodies around them. They're attacking everything near them. Now, why do you think those sharks would be attracted to this area? Because of all the blood in the water, that's right. There was a lot of blood, a lot of body parts there. They were also attracted when Indy sank. She sank 3.5 miles. And as she goes down, the pressure at those depths caused a lot of crushing and they're also attracted to the booming noises of those. So the sharks showed up in mass and they started to feast. For the first day, they mostly attacked the bodies, like I said. But it was pretty soon that they started to realize they could also eat these little guys that were swimming. Well, if you were a guy who was swimming alone, you were way more likely to be attacked than if you were in a group. And they realized this pretty quick. So they got into big groups as quick as they could. You know, held onto each other's life jackets, held onto each other. Because if you're a shark underneath and you see this big dark thing above you, it's a little bit scarier and you know, you don't know what it is. But this little guy off alone, he could be an injured seal. You know, go take him. So the guys really tried to stay together. So that was day one. When they were in the water, they started, you know, saying, oh my gosh, you know, somebody's got to come get us. Well, Jack Miner, who was one of the radio men in Radio 2, there were two radio shacks on Indy. Radio 1 was completely ruined. Radio 2 was damaged pretty bad. But Jack Miner said, he goes, you guys, I sent out an SOS. I was watching the needle jump, and it was sending a message. What he didn't realize is it wasn't sending a message. The needle was moving, but it wasn't transmitting. So nobody got their SOS calls, even though they were due to be in there the next day. So day two comes along, and they do not show up in Leyte. So at that time, in the ports, we wanted to minimize the amount of information that Japan had about our fleet. We didn't want them to know what was where, so they minimized the communications. And the standing order was, we do not report the arrival of combatant ships into port. Well, the young man who was working the plotting board that day, when Indy did not arrive, he goes, well, if we don't report the arrival, we probably don't report the non-arrival either. And he took her off the board, and she disappeared. For all intents and purposes, she was gone. Did not call and say, hey, have you seen her? Did she come there? You know, did she get diverted? He just assumed she got diverted. And she was gone. Did not send out any searching at all. On day two, this young man, Cozell Smith, would happen to be on one of those floater nets I was talking about. They were, floaters. And with a loosely knit net in the middle. And they had the most injured sailors laying in the middle of it, you know, to kind of keep them afloat. And the rest of the guys that were okay were holding on and then swimming with their other arm. Well, Cozell was one of those guys on the edge of the floater net. And he's swim. And all of a sudden, a shark just shot up front and underneath, grabbed his left arm clear up to his wrist, dug its teeth clear in, and ripped him into the ocean off of that floater net. Starts to whip him around, starts to spin him around, which is what sharks do when they're trying to kill their prey. And Cozell fought for his life. He slugged and he punched that shark as hard as he could, and it did not budge. And he said at one point, he slid his hand along the snout, found a soft spot, and jammed his fingers in there, into the shark's eye. The shark let go. And Cozell catapulted himself back up through the water, over everybody and onto that floater net. He's gonna get out of that water. He's in there amid all these other sailors, and all of a sudden one of his crew members takes out his service knife and starts slashing and screaming at Cozell, saying, get off this net, get off this net. Why do they want him out? Because he's bleeding like crazy off of his arm. That's right, he's gonna attract sharks. And he said, you know, I had about a half second to run through my brain to say, you know what? If I stay here, I'm gonna get killed for sure. I'm gonna take my chances and go back. So he jumped back off, and a friend of his ripped a piece of his shirt and helped him wrap up his arm, and he survived. One thing about Cozell Smith, he became a salesman in life. And he would travel around the US, and he would stay in hotel rooms. And more than once, the neighboring room would call the front desk or call the police because Cozell was next door screaming at the top of his lungs that he was drowning or being attacked by a shark. He was having these nightmares. So pretty horrific. So the men this day, you know, thought they were gonna be found, had no idea nobody was even looking. They move on to day three. And one thing about as the days transition, The water is about 86 degrees, which is not your body temperature. It's not super cold, but it's not your body temperature. So they are very slowly, as time is going on, getting a touch of a hypothermia. Their body temperature is going down a little bit. It's starting to mess with them. And it's getting colder at night, warmer in the day, and the sharks are bumping them. You know, things are just going very bad. Well, on day three, everything went wrong. They started to kill each other. They were hallucinating. Their minds were starting to short circuit from the lack of food, the lack of water, the sharks bumping them all the time. Photophobia, does anybody know what that is? That's the sun glinting off of the waves, burning the back of your retinas. They're going through that. They're hearing their buddies scream day and night as they're getting pulled under. They're getting washed with the bloody water as somebody gets pulled under right by them. So it's a pretty horrific scene, and they start to mentally break. So what would happen is one would look at his buddy over here and go, "Hey, there's a Jap right here." And four or five other ones would come over and attack him. And they'd drown him or stab him, or you know, they would kill him. The other hallucinations they would have is they would see an island off in the distance. And you go, "Hey, look over there. There's an island and there's a hula girl pouring lemonade." And four or five of the guys would follow him and swim off, and they'd get picked under by the sharks. The power of suggestion was very, very strong at this point. So all hell was breaking loose, and also the big groups were also splintering apart because those who were kind of keeping their wits about them did not want to be around the guys who were losing it. The guys who were losing it also started to rationalize in their mind that they could drink the water now. Why can't you drink the water if you're floating in an ocean full of water? I eat salt all the time. Why can't you drink salt water? Because the amount in the ocean is too high of a concentration for your body to process. It starts a really vicious cycle called hypernatremia. The men decided to drink this water, some of them would dive down thinking that, oh, you know, 2 or 3 feet below us, there's no salt down there. I'll just go gulp down there. Or they would hold it up in their hands and think, oh, I can just let it evaporate. The salt will evaporate out. And then they would gulp, gulp, gulp. And they had 2 hours left to live. They would start to convulse really hard. They would start to speak completely incoherently. They would foam a brown substance out of their nose and their mouth. They would do flip-flops, violent flip-flops in the water, and then they would go stiff and die. At that point, this young man, Dr. Haynes, on board the ship, he'd been on there for 4 years, he said his job, since getting into the water, he was no longer a doctor. He was a coroner. It was now his job to pronounce the men dead. So somebody would say, hey, doc, can you come and check my buddy here? I don't think he's with us still. And Doc Haynes would swim over there. He would open the sailor's eye. He would tap on it. And if the pupil did not react, they would remove the life jacket, give it to somebody else, and he would take off the sailor's dog tags. Everybody knows what dog tags are, right? They're the little necklace, little chain necklace, in case you don't know, that has a little tag on it, a metal tag that has your name, your information. And what Doc Haynes did is he put those on his wrist because he was going to get rescued. He knew he was going to get rescued. And he said, I'm going to take these because this is all they're going to have left for those families. I'm going to go visit every one of these boys' families, and I'm going to tell them about their sons. And I'm going to tell them I said the Lord's Prayer during their last moments. So when he was doing this on the third day, when things were so terrible and so many of the men were dying, his left arm, from having been doing this for so many boys, was starting to weigh him down into the ocean. It was too heavy. He said at his darkest moment in that water was that third day, when he had to remove them, drop them into the bottom of the ocean. And he knew he could never remember these boys' names. And he had nothing to give the families. That was day three. Now, This whole entire time that they are in the water, next picture, they are directly under a flight path because we are attacking Japan, the homeland, like crazy with our airplanes and our bombing. So I ask you, why weren't any of the airplanes reporting these men in the water? Why couldn't they see them? That's right. The altitude. If you ever get a chance, get on Google and just type in Adrian Marks, I've seen greatness. He wrote a speech about what it's like to be an airplane pilot and the view, the scope that you have. You're looking over 20 square miles at your altitude. And to ask someone to see these men in the water would be like asking somebody to see the period at the end of a sentence in a book from the back of this room. Couldn't be done. Well, this young man in the top right, his name is Chuck Gwynn. And Chuck Gwynn is the pilot of a PV-1 Ventura, a submarine hunter. And they are flying over the area of the Indianapolis sinking, not knowing that the Indianapolis had sunk there. What they're doing is they're testing a new antenna that is malfunctioning again. And he's really, really frustrated. So he hands over the controls to his co-pilot, and he steps to the back of the plane, opens up the hatch, and starts messing with this trailing and this sock antenna. He said for no good reason that he can account for his own self, except for the providence of God, he looks at one specific moment past what he's doing with his hands onto the ocean below. You know what he sees down there? A big black smudge of the oil, the bunker oil, correct? So you know what he knows that is? It's a submarine. It's a disabled, leaking Japanese submarine, and I'm gonna go finish it off. So he jumps back into his pilot seat. He orders everything armed to get those bomb bay doors ready because we're gonna finish this sub off. He goes out, drops altitude, comes back around to make the bomb run, and he sees something in the water. What does he see now that he's really low? He sees Dick Thielen. Dick Thielen's going, help, help. And he sees a whole bunch of these little heads and little arms just splashing and yelling. And he goes, hold off. There are men in the water. And there are too many men to be a submarine. This is a ship. But since he had read all the reports before he left base that day, he knew there were no ships in the area that had been sunk on either side. So who could this be? Well, he didn't know, but he had to make a call, so he put out an SOS. On the island of Peleliu, hold on one second, you know what? This man who spotted them in his PV-1, as he flew over them, he did this, which means, I see you, that's right. And when he did that, he earned a special name that continues to this day. Dick Thielen, what do you call Chuck Gwynn?
Angel. Called that by everybody.
Yep. He's their angel to this day, even though he has passed away. So the SOS call gets received on the island of Peleliu by this young man. His name is Adrian Marks. He's the pilot of a PBY. Now, the PV-1 Ventura cannot land on the water, but the PBY Dumbo can. Well, without waiting for any okay from his superiors, Adrian and his crew take off. And they take off toward the area for these coordinates. Halfway there, he gets a message from his command that says, okay, you're going out there. Don't you land that plane. Because open sea landings were extremely treacherous, very, very dangerous. We did not need to lose any lives. We did not need to lose this airplane. Just go out there. Plot where these men are and where we need to send these rescue ships. It's going to be hours before they get there, but let us know where they are. Just send back the information. Okay, so he goes out there and he's flying and he's graphing and charting and reporting, and he flies over a shark attack. He said he watched 50 men get pulled under by this massive group of sharks, and he grabs his mic and he radios back to base. He says, I am landing this plane. And he slammed that Dumbo down as fast as he could. He bounced 3 times in that water, popped a whole lot of rivets, and started rescuing the USS Indianapolis sailors. They filled up the entire inside, the fuselage of his Dumbo airplane, his PBY. It was full of these men who were half dead. And they were in there, and Adrian looks out, and just off to the side again, he sees another man get pulled over, or pulled under. And he says, I can't just sit here. But there's no more room. I mean, he can't fit one more body in that plane. He says, I've got to do something. I can't just sit here. I can't. And what they're doing is he's waiting for the ships to come so he can offload these guys. But he can't. So what he does is he has his crew go get their emergency supplies, which are their parachutes. He has the men that are inside the airplane crawl up onto the top of the wings, and they lash them down. They wrap them, they mummy wrap them, and lash them down to the wings. They don't roll off. And Adrian Marks, going above and beyond, saved 56 of the USS Indianapolis survivors who would not be here. My good friend, John Woolston, was a survivor who lived in Honolulu, Hawaii. He just passed away last June. He said he was as close to death as a man could be. He didn't even know if he had another 4 hours to go. He does not remember being rescued. He woke up on the top of a wing of an airplane. Thank God for Adrian Marks going above and beyond like that. So as the ships arrive and they start the rescue process, this painting very well depicts a certain scene. Two of the ships actually did this, but the one that's most famous is the USS Doyle. It showed up and was the first one to put up a spotlight straight up into the sky in the middle of the night. Is that a bad idea in the time of war? Really bad idea. And also the USS Bassett did the same thing. And they sent out these little boats, which are called LCVPs, off of the ship to go in and get the guys. So they had these boats out there. And in this painting, there are two specific men who are depicted. This one in khakis is Ensign Peter Wren. And he's old. He's 26. He's really old. But he's in charge of this rescue operation that's happening right here. And he said the first time that he got out there and went to rescue one of the men, he reached over to grab him, and the guy was reaching up. And he said, I grabbed him by his forearms, and I pulled, and the man had been in this caustic, corrosive salt water for 5 days, and his skin ripped off, down to the muscle and bone. He said, I learned real quick I had to grab them by their life jackets and haul them over. Now, remember these life jackets? How long were they supposed to float? 48 to 72 hours. We're on day 5. A lot of these men, when they put them on originally because they didn't want to slip out of them, knotted them to holy heck and couldn't get them off. So by the time that they were picked up, their buoyancy had decreased so badly and they'd absorbed so much water, they were up to almost their mouths in the ocean. So Peter Wren is hauling them in. Well, the problem is some of these guys, like I said, that were delirious, did not want to get rescued. And they thought they were Japanese trying to come and kill them. Well, over here in this lower corner, there's a floater net depicted. And the men on that floater net were refusing to get rescued. They wouldn't come over to the LCVP. They wouldn't get rescued. So this young man right here with the big arms, he's a 19-year-old football player named Bill Van Wilpe. Lives in Wanacue, New Jersey. Played football, big burly tree of a man till the day he died just a few years ago. But he's a brand new little 19-year-old in the Navy. He jumps out into the shark-infested water, swims over to this floater net where these guys are hanging on, refusing to get saved. And he goes, hey, guys, see that LCVP over there? There's girls on there. A whole lot of guys got rescued. He did that swim back and forth from midnight until 6 a.m. and saved so many lives. When he went back to Wanacue, New Jersey, he resumed, after the war, he went to work for the school district, and he was a janitor forever and ever and ever for decades. And when Doug Stanton wrote his book, In Harm's Way, which came out in the '99, 2000, it was in his school library. And his librarian was reading it. And Doug talks about Bill in this because Peter Wren told Doug about Bill. And his librarian's reading it. She gets to this part, oh, you know, the rescue, da, da, da. Bill Van Wilpy. We have a Bill Van Wilpy at our school. So she takes the book over to Bill. They're at school one day. She goes, Bill, the USS Indianapolis book. Says Bill Van Wilpy right there. Is that you? And he goes, oh, shit. He hadn't even told his parents that he'd been part of this. He had seen some really horrible stuff swimming out there among the body parts and trying to rescue men who were dead. So he was pretty traumatized himself. But he was also honored 60 years later with a medal for doing that brave service. Now, on day five, when the last survivor and Captain McVeigh was one of the last survivors picked up, and he was lucky enough to have found a raft, one of the very few rafts. He was one of the last. Out of 1,195 sailors who were on that ship 5 days earlier, how many were still alive? 316. Three quarters of the crew died in that 5 days. So they take these men into their ships, into their rescue ships. Look how covered in oil that is. And they babied them. They gave them their own clothing. They let them sleep in their bunks. They got into the shower with them to help scrub them off. They fed them. They took such gentle, wonderful care that when these men see any of the rescuers at the reunions, it's a pretty tender scene, I'll tell you what. Okay, go on. They then transported the men to the various hospitals in the area. This is a picture in Guam. They were in bad shape. Go ahead. When the Navy realized that there were going to be about 900 families of dead sailors they were going to have to answer to, they needed to blame somebody, don't they? Of course you do. Who do they decide to blame? Captain McVeigh. He's going to be the perfect scapegoat. So they decided to bring him up on two charges in a court-martial. The first one was failure to order a timely abandoned ship. Your ship sank in 12 minutes. What they found out is he ordered that at minute number 8, which is fine. Okay, so that one's fine. The second charge was failure to zigzag. Correct. Because he was not zigzagging during that moment when the clouds parted, when he was sleeping and there happened to be a submarine. And they convicted him on that. As part of the testimony, they brought in a witness that nobody was happy with. They brought in the commander of the submarine that sank. Ooh, you think the country was on fire about that? So Hashimoto came over to testify against the captain. And what he said was, I can't believe you're doing this. Why is your country doing this to your captain? And it wouldn't have mattered if he was zigzagging. I would have nailed him anyway. It was the most perfect shot I could have ever asked for. And they mistranslated it. And they totally disregarded his testimony. And they convicted Captain McVeigh. So at that point, immediately, his life changed. Go ahead. He never commanded at sea again. He had a desk job. He ended up going into selling insurance, moving to Louisiana with his lovely wife, Louise. Louise, who he adored, got a new job too. She became a mail sensor. You guys know what mail sensors do? They make sure certain things don't get read. What she was intercepting on behalf of the captain were Christmas cards and other holiday cards, because what they were getting from some of the lost at sea families were cards that said, Dear Captain McVeigh, Merry Christmas. I hope you're having fun celebrating while my husband lies dead at the bottom of the ocean. Because of you, my son is dead. Because of you, you know, on and on and on. And this went on for years. And she would intercept these so he would not see them. And they went on. Well, in 1960, well, I'm going to back up a little bit. In 1958, in Sunbury, North Carolina, there was a survivor named Felton Outland. And he barely survived. And he credited his survival to a man named Giles McCoy, who was a Marine that was with him in a raft. And he felt so indebted to Giles McCoy that he woke up one Saturday morning and he said, in 1958, he said, 13 years later, he goes, I have got to go thank him. I need to thank him right now. I need to thank him right now. So he tells his wife, he says, Viola, get the kids to your sister's. We're going on a road trip. Okay. So she does. And they drove to Milwaukee. And they bound Giles McCoy. Didn't tell Giles they were coming. Just showed up on his door. And when Giles opened the door, Felton fell onto him, sobbing and saying, thank you. Thank you for saving my life. And they spent the next few days with Giles and his wife. After he left, after Felton went back to North Carolina, Giles McCoy thought, you know what? That was really good. Maybe the rest of us need to do the same thing. And he started to put together the first reunion. He thought, let's gather. So in 1960, the first reunion was held in Indianapolis at the Hotel Severin. And as many of the men that could or would or that they could find came to that first reunion. They also invited Captain McVeigh. Guess who didn't want to go? Captain McVeigh. He was scared to death. He thought, my men probably blame me. What he didn't know is that his men did not blame him. The minute that that court-martial was pronounced in 1945, these guys went crazy. And they rose up and said, this is wrong, he didn't do this, he's not at fault. They wrote letters to their congressmen, senators, presidents, ignored the whole way. He didn't know about any of that. But he reluctantly agreed to come when Giles McCoy contacted him. And when he stepped off that plane in Indianapolis, at the bottom of those stairs, because back then you didn't have the jetway, you had the stairs, there were two rows of survivors in full salute, tears streaming. They were so happy to see their captain. And they had a wonderful weekend of a reunion there. And what they did at one point is they made the ladies go over there. And they got together in a certain room together, alone, and they got into their groups that they were in the water, and they processed. That was their PTSD. That's how they dealt with it. So all these years later, they're still gathering. They still go to their reunions, and I'll tell you what, there's a meeting that none of the rest of us are allowed in. They go in and they have their survivors-only meeting. Well, this was 1960. In 1965, Louise passed away from cancer. And Captain started getting the letters. Sorry. 2 days ago, November 6th, 1968, he had received the first Christmas card from the Lawson C family that hated him. And he took his service revolver and he went out on his front porch and put it to his head and took his own life. More appropriately, the USS Indianapolis took down her last victim when Captain died that day. When this hit the news and the survivors found out about it, they rose up again. He said, you guys, our captain wasn't to blame. Look what this did to his life. He wasn't to blame. And again, they were ignored. Nobody was going to help him. Well, we're going to fast forward to 1996. There's a little 11-year-old, almost 12-year-old boy named Hunter Scott in Pensacola, Florida. And he is watching this movie. Not sure I let my kids watch that at 11 years old. But okay, he's watching it with his dad. How many of you guys have seen Jaws? Good, we're gonna watch a piece of it right now. Lights, please.
Thank you. What's that one?
What?
That one there, on your arm.
Oh, it's a tattoo. I got that removed.
Don't tell me. Don't tell me. Mother.
What is that? Tahupa, that's the USS Indianapolis.
You were on the Indianapolis?
What happened?
Japanese submarine slammed two torpedoes into our side, Chief. He was coming back from the island of Tinian to Lady, just delivered the bomb, the Hiroshima bomb. 1,100 men went into the water. Vessel went down in 12 minutes. Didn't see the first shark for about half an hour. Tiger, 13-footer. You know that when you're in the water, Chief? You tell by looking from the dorsal to the tail. Well, we didn't know. Was our bomb mission had been so secret. No distress signal had been sent. They didn't even list as overdue for a week. Very first light, Chief. Sharks come cruising. So we formed ourselves into tight groups. You know, it's kind of like old squares in a battle, like you see in a calendar, like the Battle of Waterloo, and the idea was, shark comes to the nearest man, that man, he start pounding and hollering and screaming. Sometimes the shark go away. Sometimes he wouldn't go away. Sometimes that shark, he looks right into you, right into your eyes. You know the thing about a shark, he's got lifeless eyes, black eyes, like a doll's eyes. When he comes at you, he doesn't seem to be living until he bites you. And those black eyes roll over white, and then... Oh, then you hear that terrible high-pitched screaming. The ocean turns red, and in spite of all the pounding and the hollering, they all come in and they rip you to pieces. You know, by the end of that first dawn, lost 100 men. I don't know how many sharks, maybe 1,000. I don't know how many men, they average 6 an hour. On Thursday morning, Chief, I bumped into a friend of mine, Herbie Robinson from Cleveland. Baseball player, bosun's mate. I thought he was asleep. Reached over to wake him up. Bobbed up and down in the water. It was like a kind of top. Upended. Well, he'd been bitten in half below the waist. Noon the fifth day, Mr. Hooper, Lockheed Ventura saw us. He swung in low and he saw us too. A young pilot, a lot younger than Mr. Hooper anyway, he saw us and he come in low. And 3 hours later, a big fat PBY comes down and start to pick us up. You know, that was the time I was most frightened, waiting for my turn. I'll never put on a life jacket again. So 1,100 men went in the war. 316 men come out. The sharks took the rest June the 29th, 1945. Anyway, we delivered the bomb.
So I guess you have heard the indie story before, haven't you? So little Hunter Scott is watching this. When that part came on, he stood up in front of the TV and he said, "Dad, did that really happen?" His dad goes, "Yeah, get out of the way of the TV. The big attack is coming." A little later, his dad was talking to him. He said, "You know, you're getting ready to do a history fair project. Why don't you do it about that?" So they start researching. They don't find a whole lot. There's just not a whole lot out there about the Indianapolis at this time. So what he does is he puts out a little classified ad in the local paper. And he gets an answer. He's looking for a survivor to interview. In Mobile, Alabama, there's Maurice Bell. So little Hunter Scott goes over there and meets with Maurice in his home, and he tells him his story and shows him his Purple Heart. And as he's leaving, he gives him a list of all the Indianapolis survivors' contact information, because Hunter wants to contact them. So he goes home and he writes letters to get information for his history fair project. And he says basically four things. What'd you do before the war? What'd you do on the ship? How the heck did you survive those 5 days? What do you think about your captain's court-martial that Maurice had told him about? The men who did and would respond wrote back and they gave him the information. Down to that last question, they went crazy. They were still so angry all these years later that their captain had been blamed for this. And they sent Hunter Scott so much stuff to back up his history fair project. They sent him documents, photographs, dog tags, order, everything. I mean, they sent him a ton of stuff. And he made this great project. Well, he wins his school level, you know, because there's tiers to winning this. And what Hunter had told these guys in his letter was, he goes, you know what? Because of what happened to your captain, I'm going to get him exonerated with my sixth grade project. Okay. Well, what happens is he wins his school level. He gets up to the district level, gets up to the state level, and he gets disqualified. What happened was, you know, he gets down there and sees that he's been disqualified. He pulls aside one of the judges and he goes, why did I get disqualified? What's wrong? The judge goes, right here in the rules, you cannot have as part of your display, back it up one, Mitchell. You cannot have, down here you can't see it, this white thing at the very bottom. You cannot have as part of your display a spiral bound notebook, which was one of the sailors' diaries. So they disqualified him for that. Well, he's pretty upset. Well, his dad, Alan, asked his friend, who was Joe Scarborough, who's a local politician, to kind of help, you know, soothe Hunter's wounds. Could you display his project in your waiting room of your office? Joe says yes, puts this thing out there, and notices that when people come in to talk to him, they are on fire about what they just read in the waiting room. So he finally goes out there and looks at it, and he gets to the part about the captain, and he calls Hunter and he goes, what do you have to back this up? And he goes, oh, you should see what I have. I have a ton of stuff. And he does. He owns the second largest USS Indianapolis collection, second only to the museum itself. So Joe Scarborough took little Hunter and they went north to Washington, D.C. And from the age of 12 to 16, every year they went and they lobbied a bill through Congress. They fought and fought. They kept getting shot down. They kept going back. And the reason that Hunter was able to make some headway was why? He's a kid. I mean, who cares what these old guys think? Who's this kid that cares about World War II history? In his quest for attention, to get attention on this story, go ahead, Mitchell, he gets written up in People magazine, and he goes on David Letterman. So he's getting that story out there because, dang, this is so cool that this kid is fighting for this man who, you know, had already passed away so many years before, but he's fighting for his honor. Well, in doing all of this, in the year 2000, guess what happened? He testified in front of the Senate Armed Services Committee, and Captain McVeigh was exonerated. Hunter has a whole lot of grandpas. So that was a wonderful, wonderful day. In the year 2000, the Discovery Channel sent out a search with an ROV, which is a remote underwater vehicle, over the area of the last reported where Indy was. And they went out there for 30 days with four of the survivors who have since passed away. None of those men are with us anymore. They went out there and they looked and they recorded a really great documentary called In Search of the USS Indianapolis by the Discovery Channel. If you ever get a chance to see it, it's fantastic. And they didn't find it, but they dropped over a granite marker engraved with some words for their lost at sea crewmen. And they dropped that over the edge before they left. So this is my, I call him my survivor. This is Eugene Morgan. He lived in Seattle, not far from me, and we did a whole lot of presentations together in the area. And if you ever get to, have you guys seen the movie USS Indianapolis, The Legacy? Has anybody seen that? The documentary where it's actually the survivors that are talking? Has anybody seen it? If you have not, I recommend you watch it. Dick's in it a whole lot. So you'll want to see that because he's cute. Eugene's all, did you just laugh at your dad, Dave? I thought you did. You can ground him still. You know that. Eugene's in there quite a bit too. And he keeps saying in his interviews, when I die, I want to go back and be with my shipmates. When I die, I want to be cremated and go back and be with my shipmates. So when he passed away suddenly from a heart attack in 2008, I got a call from his daughter and she said, we want you to come and speak at his funeral. So I did. And afterwards, we were in the waiting room of the family and his young grandson, Jason Witte, was serving on board a nuclear submarine at the time. And we're in this back room of the funeral home and he goes, I'm gonna tell my captain that we're gonna, surface and I'm gonna dump grandma's ashes. And I'm going, yeah, your captain's gonna listen to you. You're nobody. We'll all be darned if 6 months or even in October of that same year, this is what went all around the world on the AP press. Jason Witte had a full 21-gun salute, got his nuclear submarine to surface, and poured his grandfather's ashes over the site of the sinking, fulfilling his wishes. Go ahead. In 2004, when I got involved, after reading Doug Stanton's book called In Harm's Way, I tracked down my local survivor in Utah, where I was living at the time, Woody James, who was a bear of a man. He was a big, big teddy bear. And I flew Hunter Scott in, who at that time was 19 years old. And he spent a good week and a half with us, with our family. We did a lot of fun things in the area. And we did our very first USS Indianapolis presentation. At the very beginning of it, I thought we were going to have 40 or 50 people. Then the word got out to the public schools that this was going to happen. And kind of like what happened here tonight, you guys, I thought we were going to have 300 or 400 people. I ended up having to rent the ballroom of the local university. 300 or 400 people, we had 1,100 show up. So I apologize, this does happen because this story is so in demand to hear because we know we're losing them very quickly. And it's such an important story to hear. So that was 2004. Go ahead. This is Hunter now. Look who's in the Navy. Look who is a submarine hunter helicopter pilot. Hunter, do you know who he's standing with right there? That's Hashimoto's daughter. This is at the USS Indianapolis reunion. The survivors invite his family every year, and they attend. And if you want to see beautiful, you guys, if you want to know what forgiveness is, come to this. It's open to the public. It's always in July, and we're getting fewer and fewer of them in there every year. But we also have Hashimoto's family. His grandkids and his great-grandkids are playing with Dick's grandkids and great-grandkids, and it's beautiful. So there's that. August 19th of last year, I got a call at 6 o'clock in the morning. It was a Saturday. I was dead asleep. And Sarah Vladek, who made the documentary, The Legacy, and who also wrote the book, the bestseller book that's out there, called Indianapolis, she called me at 6 a.m. And she said three words. They found her. And I knew exactly immediately what she meant. And neither of us got excited. Neither of us whooped and hollered. Neither of us, did a celebration dance. It was so reverent, I can't even describe. About 5 minutes later, she texted me this picture. She said, do not release this. It's not going out until 9 a.m. Pacific time. We have to notify all the survivors in the next 3 hours before they read it in the newspaper or see it online. So we did. And at that time, there were 19 of them. And you guys don't answer the phone at 6 in the morning on a Saturday. You were hard to get a hold of. But we got them. We notified all of them before it broke in the press. And it was a beautiful thing. And in talking with Sarah and also Commander Bill Toady, who is the captain of the USS Indianapolis SSN 697 submarine namesake, he was the other one that called the survivors. None of these guys whooped and hollered. It was very reverent, like I said. And then we started notifying the lost at sea families that we now knew where their loved ones were. It was a beautiful day. This is the one of the images that's released. This is the ship. 1 mile away is the bow. That's that front section that got sheared off with that first torpedo. And when they found the ship, and I got the news, I immediately hopped the next flight and flew to Honolulu to be with John Woolston, the survivor over there, because I knew he was going to have a rough time. He had been in the worst of the worst shark attack group. And he was also one of the men who testified at Captain McVeigh's unsuccessful court-martial. He also tried to get him exonerated by doing what he could. But he also wrote the war damage report after the sinking. And he wanted to know if he got it right. So when this got found, I went to be with him to help him through this emotionally. And at that same week that I was there, the crew from the ship that found Indianapolis came to his house in Honolulu. And we sat down together and looked at the first pictures of the Indianapolis at the bottom of the ocean. And I'll tell you what, he had one word that he said over and over as he looked at these scans. When he laid eyes on his ship for the first time in 73 years, he kept saying, fantastic, fantastic. And it wasn't fantastic, roo, rah, rah. It was overwhelming, fantastic. And it was a really neat thing to behold, to see him react to that. So the next thing that you're gonna see is a tribute video that I made years ago. If the man on the screen is only young, he did not survive. So obviously the rest of the survivors. I want you guys to just pay attention to this, and please remember not just Dick Thielen and his shipmates, the other 315 besides him that came home, but the 879 who did not. Can we have the lights, please?
Who on earth knows why? Some men live and some men die. He was a better man than I, or would have been when we were boys. We were nearly 1,200 souls, watching how war takes its toll. It hates to watch the young grow old, it seeks and it destroys. Tinian, we were bound to deliver the end from above the ground. Never knew a thing, never heard a sound. We got her there on time. Then we pushed off for more torpedoes from the ocean floor. Cut us in two with a mighty roar, and war, nothing's a crime. Captain says, boys, we gotta go. A 900 jumps into the water below. Those that could not see still could hear when the Indianapolis, when she disappeared. We thought they'd come when the sun had rose, but the sharks, they gathered in the world. Footers from the tail to the nose. Well, this was not war. Some boars thrashed, some lay prone, some were bitten half, some were left alone. All we had to give was flesh and bone. Tell me, what are you fighting for? Thank you. 4 days we died. Some floated away when the night flew by. Others with madness in their eye, I can still hear the sounds. Calls for loved ones in the air, and whoops for things that just weren't there. Chattering teeth and the Lord's Prayer with the devil all around. That PV-1 finally came, called the PBY, and the ship's the same. You learn all about luck in war, cause we weren't exactly what they were looking for. Seventeen survive, so there's that many men asking why. How do I live when I've watched men die? Where did they all go? You may seek to blame, state your case, make your claim, stick your brass up in a frame, because you'll never know. Never got further than the sand. Dreams can bring me back and force my hand like it was yesterday. I put a seashell to my ear. Grandson says, Papa, what do you hear? I'll turn so he can't see the tears. Someone tell me what to say. Captain says, boys, we gotta go. 900 jumped into the water below. Three hundred seventeen survived, so there's that many men asking why. Who on earth knows why? Some men live and some. He was a better man than I, or he would have been. We were just boys.
Ladies and gentlemen, never forget, never, ever give up. I want to introduce to you my hero, Dick Thielen, USS Indianapolis survivor. Do you want?
Thank you. I don't deserve all this. All I did is I thought my job, and I did it. Thank you. I can't thank her enough.
Oh, shh. I'm going to let your son talk first, because I want him to bring this up, bring your story into how he found out about it. This is David Thielen.
Hi, I'm David. I got two older brothers and three younger sisters. In 1975, I was a senior in high school. I went and saw the movie Jaws. I'm kind of emotional, but watching them guys talk, the three guys, that's the only part I remember about the whole movie. So I went home that night. My mom was reading a book. It's about midnight. My mom says, son, what'd you do tonight? I said, I went and saw the movie Jaws. And he talked about these guys in USS Indianapolis. I laid in the ocean, getting ate by sharks and all that stuff. And my mom kind of chuckled a little bit. And she says, I said, Mom, what are you chuckling about? Me being a smart ass 18-year-old. She goes, talk to your dad in the other room about it. I go, what's he know about it? He was on that ship. I didn't know. That's the first time I knew. That was 1975. I've been to every reunion since 1975. I'm 61 now. My dad and I go all over, talk about what experience. I'm very emotional the last couple of days because what Kim put together, it's just amazing what these guys went through. I don't know how my dad is not crying like I'm crying, because I got to know a lot of families when all these guys were, that their families were there. I got to mess around with the kids and everything, and They're part of our family. Everybody, all the Indianapolis family, we're family. I've been to Florida, out east, out west, everywhere. When I walk in the door, he says, we're family. You don't pay for nothing, we're family. And that's how the Indianapolis people were. I'm gonna tell a little story about my mom. My mom died in 2002, but my mom and dad were married 7 years. And my mom didn't know nothing about it. My dad couldn't talk about it. So I'm gonna let, you guys gonna ask some great stories. My dad's gonna tell some great stories. And I'm gonna let it go back to my dad, so thank you.
Years ago, I didn't talk about it. For the last 25, 30 years, it's really picked up the last 5 years. Since they found the ship, the monument, all the books out, the movies, and so many other things that multiply. I didn't think it would ever happen. But Dave and I go at least 3 times a month someplace, and sometimes 4 or 5 times a month. Most of the time, it's around town or nearby, not this far away from the home, but that way. But we were called New York City to put the chat. The losing or finding the ship, and I helped put the program together. I think it was tremendous. What's the name of it, David?
USS Indianapolis, live from the deep.
Was on channel 23 at home. Anyhow, so many of us guys are heroes, but we weren't. We just do our thing, and also it'd been easier to die out there. It was to stay alive. And they're talking about sharks. 2 different times the shark come up and poked me in my life jacket. I got kind of unconscious a little bit. He looked me over and swam away. Twice this happened. And he bounced around my legs quite a bit. He used to teach me how to work. The sharks didn't attack me because I was bigger than the shark. So I didn't think that. But I found out later that sharks don't like diesel fuel. And I was saturated with it. I was really black. So I think really down saved my life. And a lot of people ask about after in the hospitals and everything. We had a lot of saltwater ulcers and memories and nightmares and everything else. And she's asking me to tell this story. Anyhow, when you're ready to go potty, for example, I had to grab hold of a stanchion someplace that every time I urinated, it hurt to come out for about 10, 12 days. But back then, young whippersnapper, you know, I hope it didn't, the salt water didn't hurt that. Because, because I really wanted to use it for what it was used for. And I had 6 kids.
Colin, you owe everybody a refund in here right now.
We could say that at the school today. We could say.
Yeah, we couldn't tell that at the school.
Adults.
Probably shouldn't. When I showed you my survivor, Eugene Morgan from Seattle, we were doing a program one time, and a kid stood up, and this is in front of a school, and he said, "Did you get bit by a shark?" And Eugene goes, "Well, let me tell you." He took the mic, and I'm going, "Oh, don't you start lying, because I know you did not get bit by a shark." And Eugene goes, "You know," he goes, "it's the third day, and I was hanging onto the side of a raft, because the inside was still filled with the really injured guys. And off in the distance," he goes, "I saw something. I don't know if I was hallucinating, but I saw something. And everything in me said, swim to that." He goes, "So I left the raft, and I started swimming." And he said, when he got about halfway there, everybody behind him was screaming, "Morgan, Morgan, shark!" He said, "I turned around, and there was the fin." Now, Eugene Morgan had been sleeping topside, like I told you that night. And he was only in his skivvies. Do you guys know what skivvies are? It's underpants. That's right, he's in his underwear. Anyway, he's swimming along in his underwear, going to this thing off in the distance, and the shark's coming at him. He sees the fin. And the shark comes up and he bumps him, like Dick's talking about, which is what they do. They kind of test and see what you are. And kept on swimming. He goes, whew, until it did the U-turn. Came back. He said, "I watched his mouth open. And I saw the teeth, and it grabbed my skivvies and ripped them clean off." And he goes, "The only reason that I'm here talking to you, young man, is because that shark did not like Polish sausage, and I'm Polish." To the kids!
Thank you for all coming, but I could stand here and tell you stories for another 4, 5, 6 hours, not just the sinking or in the water or the sharks, but just what happened to Navy reunions. I got in contact with so many. There's only 14 of us today. And last week, there were only 5 there, including me. It's a funny damn feeling, because years ago, I had 200 people sitting around me as survivors. Now there's only 4.
Yes. Yeah. Tell them how you came. What did your dad do for you?
Okay.
That's a very important thing.
All right. My dad signed for me to go to the Navy. I come home from boot camp, and he took me back to the railroad station, shook my hand, he's a strong man. And he confirmed me, he said, "Dick, I want you to come home." Well, you probably know this. In April of 45, the war was winding down in Europe. So I said, "Don't worry, Dad. The war is putting it over. It ain't going to happen to me." So anyhow, in the water, I could see my dad's face, and I could feel his grip. I said, "I'm coming home for him," and I did. And I come home, and I told him, I said, "How in hell did I do that?" "Well, you did it, Dad." That's all I got to say, you did it. True story.
So at this time, we're gonna open up to questions from the audience. If you'd like to ask Dick anything, this is your chance. And I'll tell you what, this labor of love that Colin does, my goodness. You guys, this isn't gonna happen again. You know, tomorrow is not promised for these guys at all. We did the presentation in Washington State in April, and by a month and a half later, that survivor passed away. So take this chance to ask Dick anything you'd like. Colin has the microphone. Yeah. You'll need to stand up. So who would like to ask something?
Yep, raise your hand.
Just here you go, Colin.
Kiddos in 5th grade.
Yeah, sometimes I don't hear that well.
Hi, I just like to know what do you think the future holds? What are you going to do with your organization going forward?
What are you going to do with the survivors organization going forward?
Well, I don't know. Well, you take the Pearl Harbor organization. I understand just last year they disbanded because there was nobody left. I think the kid, our family, my kids, are going to continue on with this after we're all gone. I mean, let's face it, there's only 14 left. There was 99 from Michigan, 19 came off alive. I'm the only one left out of Michigan. The rest of us, a few of us scattered around the country. But I think we accomplished so much through the reunion. The biggest thing is get the captain car. We really worked our butt off on it and helped. The monument downtown Indianapolis, the museum, all the books, and just like me going here and talking, and a lot of other guys are talking. So in other words, I think we accomplished a lot after the sinking. I hope that word is right.
Well, for what it's worth, I agree. I think you're doing the right thing.
If you're interested, there's an organization that just got formed. It is called the Legacy Organization. If you go to ussindianapolis.com, you can join the Legacy Organization to help carry on. Like I said, reunions are open to the public. Go ahead.
I'm just curious. I watched the movie, and I've been, of course, reading.
Which movie?
You know what? I don't remember. It was the one, I just don't remember it. It's quite a few years ago. And I was just wondering if he's watched them and if he thinks that they're pretty accurate.
Have you watched the movies?
Oh, don't start me on that. I don't know if anybody can remember or not. I'd say, let me think, about 25 years ago on CBS, Sunday Night Movies. I don't know if you know it. Anyhow, they had one on the ship. My wife and I went to California for the premiere. Stacy Keith was a guy as a captain. And myself and about, I think there was 22 others, told Stacy Keith it was a real sloppy movie, the whole setup. We had survivors, young man, live within 25, 30 miles, two survivors in Hollywood where they made it. They never contacted one survivor, not one. They never asked them. The movie this came out here years ago, there was no survivors ever contacted.
That one is called Men of
Courage. I don't know, figured that out yet.
That one is called Men of Courage, U.S. Indianapolis Men of Courage, and it stars Nicolas Cage as the captain, and it is the worst travesty against this story. These guys are furious about that movie.
That's the one
each movie has to be rated, I understand, before they put it in all the movies in the country. This is rated so low that they don't put it in the movies. Now, how bad can you get?
I know you say that you didn't really do anything except doing your job, but I think a lot of credit has to be given to you for what you do. The traveling.
Thank you. I go to a lot of schools, and some people ask me, say, what good is it going around talking to them school kids? Well, I got a box at home. I bet there's at least 500, 600, 700 letters in there from school kids that wrote to me afterward. You come over to my house, you sit down and read those letters, and then ask me that question. I think I'm doing real good. I told the kids today, for God's sakes, if you're on drugs, get off of it. If you're not on it, don't start.
Well,
and you're going to have a lot of trials and tribulations in life. I did with my afterwards, my job, raising six kids, you know. It's no picnic. Life is no picnic. You guys know that well as I do. I don't mean stand up here and be a preacher. Don't get me wrong. I'm not.
I first became interested a few years ago when I read the book In Harm's Way, and I went to work and I was talking to a gentleman about it, and he said, I have something I need to tell you. And so a day later he came in with a picture of his uncle who was on USS Indianapolis, and he didn't survive, and I was just curious if you knew him. His name was Neil Braun.
Neil.
What was the last name?
Braun, B-R-E-U-N.
Did you know Neil Braun lost his
He survived?
No.
He was lost?
No. Well, I am saying, I knew very few because I just come on board This is the first trip out for me. I was green as grass. I didn't know beans from buttons, you know. And but I survived. But anyhow, no, I know a few in my division, but that's all I knew. And I knew them by sight, some of them, but I never did hear their names or nothing. But no, that was you couldn't know 1,200 men.
I know. All right.
Impossible.
Thank you.
Okay.
We have a question here in the middle.
Okay. I don't have a question, but I do have a story, and my wife is probably sick to death of hearing it.
My recruiting officer,
when I, in 1955, when I went into the service, into the Navy, I was 17 years old. I turned 17 in June, and in October, I was in Great Lakes getting my butt kicked around. But anyway, my recruiting officer was my dad's cousin, who was a Pearl Harbor survivor. He was on the USS California when it went down in Pearl Harbor. They were a command abandoned ship. He dove and jumped into the water with the oil on it and swam through the fire and everything over to Ford Island, where he was picked up. And he was missing in action and presumed dead from the 7th of December till the 23rd of December, when they finally notified his parents that he was indeed alive. But like I said, he did survive, and he was my recruiting officer. And I don't care how much my wife hates this story, but I'm going to keep telling this story as long as I have breath, because I was proud of my uncle.
Well, so many people, well, some of the veterans here, I bet they got stories. It was not too pretty either. I know friends that spent, say, a year in the foxhole or in the islands out there in the Pacific in them swamp and fighting and everything. Me, 5 days in the water, 5 days out, and then I was in the hospital, getting all better, recovering. That was a short period of time. Sure, it was a 5 days, but a lot of people spent foxholes for a year, year and a half. I talked to a couple of men, at one time veterans deal. They were going from the Pacific, I mean the Atlantic War, I get the European War, to the Philippines for the Japanese War. In other words, they weren't even coming home. Big transport ship. They got halfway there and they got their information, they dropped the atomic bomb, the war was over. And I met some of them guys, and they met me, they could kiss me. So they thought it was a big deal, brought the bomb over. And I had some good friends I found out after I got home. They were sitting in the Philippines waiting for the invasion of Japan. When we took the bomb over there for them, then they came home. I didn't know that till years afterwards. But there's so many stories that I could stand here for talk for a long time on them. And most of them are good stories. For example, I got acquainted with the Navy with Harold Eck from New Orleans. We've become real close friends. Not just me, the kids were, her kids were. Anyhow, I was so close to him, I went to 5 Mardi Gras in the state fair, in the World Fair. And that's close. That's where we were. And Chuck Gwynn, the pilot of the plane, we became close friends. He lived in California, we lived in Michigan. He had a daughter that married a man who was a big shot in Chrysler Motor in Bloomfield Hill. So every time he come to see his daughter, he'd call me up. We'd go over to his house. We'd go in someplace, the world. In other words, he came to my house several times to eat. In other words, we got together. And we were real, real close friends when he died. He died in 95. 45. But a tremendous man. And another thing about these pilots, Adrian Marks, a lot of people didn't realize him when she gave the presentation. He didn't even know who was in that water. There were men, that's all he knew. He didn't know where the hell they came from. And that guy sacrificed his life and his 9-man crew to put that plane down and bring these men, you know, pick them up. And he didn't know who the hell they were. And that's a hero. A lot of people don't realize that.
Dick, I don't know if you remember me. We met in July. I was at the reunion.
What's your name, honey?
Julia.
Do you remember Julia at the reunion?
No.
Okay, well.
Well, there was so, I'm awful
people.
Bad at remembering names.
It's okay.
And
I got your autograph. Anyway, I got to know Sarah Vladek, and it's because everybody's got a story, and there was, you know, almost 1,200 men who went down on that ship, and everybody had a life.
Oh, yeah.
And a big story. And I just want to share mine a little bit real quickly. Wausau's not that big of a city, and not too far from here is Antigo. And my uncle was from Antigo, and he was one of the few survivors. He died in 1963 of an enlarged heart from floating on the water. He had just retired from the military, did his 20 years and got out. And he had bought a house in Stevens Point. And he was finally going to get married and settle down. And he climbed up on the roof to do some remodeling on the house he just built. And he died of a heart attack.
Okay. Yeah.
So I never really got to know him, but I heard a lot of stories. And a couple of things that got back to me was fried potatoes. That was what one of the things that kept him going. He looked forward to his mother's home, fried potatoes. And another thing he talked about was he must have been in one of the larger groups that floated because they hooked legs. He said that they hooked legs, and so they were like a big donut so that the sharks from underneath, like you talked about earlier, they thought it was like a big boat or something too big to attack. So I just thought I'd share that.
What was his name?
Edward Keyes.
Keyes.
K-E-Y-E-S. So.
Well, see, they call floating nets, you know, the ropes with net or corks on it. And some of them guys are in them, and that kind of kept the sharks away a little bit, see. But most of us are just Cape-Ot life jackets, including myself. A Cape-Ot's got a seam going up here. And it was, it was an old jacket. Because where that seam is, the threads are popping apart. And there's a funny feeling in them peat pods in that life jacket. When they come out of that life jacket, hit you in the nose, that means you're going down. It's a honey, funny, funny feeling.
Is there another question? Oh, I'm sorry.
Doing good. Okay. Hello, I'm an Army vet myself, and I was just kind of curious, what made you want to decide Navy versus any other branch in the military?
How did you choose the Navy?
Oh, I was a swimmer in high school. I wanted to be around water. So I was around it. No, I like to be around boats. Okay, after I got married, I had a house trainer, a camp trainer. I took all these kids swimming. I had three different boats, a little boat. As the kids got bigger, I had to buy a bigger boat so I could water ski. In other words, and I learned them how to swim. My wife and I went on three cruises, so I still like water. I don't do any swimming no more, though. There.
Okay.
Hi, I just wondered, when you were in the water, how large the group was that you were with, and what you did.
It's Sunday night, Monday, most of the day, the water was, I'd say, 8 to 10 foot swells. And you couldn't tell how many your group, because you're just coming up. Only time you could see anything top of that swell, you'd be going down or coming up. We rode the swells till about Tuesday morning, it kind of calmed down. Then, and Tuesday, in my group, or the group I was in, the sharks moved in. So they start picking the guys off. It's a funny feeling. We try and stay in a group, but then somebody would swim about from here, David, or a little further, and then you hear him scream. Then an hour or two later, or thereabouts, you seen a pile of blood floating by you. And that's a funny feeling, believe me. It really gets you thinking. I mean, you know, nothing against it, but it's, I can't subscribe it for that one. You know.
Sorry, I'm, oh.
Hello. As a mother of a 19 and 17-year-old boy, I can't help but think what made you as a 17-year-old want to join the service, that you approached your father.
Trying to.
Why at 17 did you want to
do war? I always blame my dad. He signed me going 17. He wanted to get rid of me real bad. In other words, okay. Some of the students asked me today about mandatory service every year, 6 months, when they come 17, 18 years old. I think it's a good deal. You learn a lot to start and learn responsibility, not being away from home and different things. Well, here a while ago, a friend of mine from the KC, I was there. I was out there and they wanted to go to eat something, which I did. They asked me to come with them. They had their daughter with them, and her son was just going in the Marines, or in the Marines for a while, and he's real homesick, he can't tell her. And the daughter says, so old. So I said, well, how old is he? He's 19. I was this age after 19. In other words, I said, he's gonna grow up. In other words, that was part of my theory, is when you go into service, you get away from home, get away from your dad and mother, and grow up and see what the fact of life is. That's my opinion. I hope I answered your question.
Okay. We're gonna take one more question because I know a lot of people want to get around you for autographs and for other books. So we'll take one question here.
I was just wondering what you remember about the time when you were on the ship from the torpedo attack until going into the water, what your experience was with the actual sinking.
Tell them where you were when the torpedoes hit.
Oh, yeah. I was. I got a picture. I haven't got a picture of the ship, have
you? You might get it back.
Can you get a picture of the ship? I can explain it to you right quick.
Tell them what they're doing, that the five things that.
Oh, okay. I forgot about
when
that.
When they're trying to get this back.
There's five things that actually stand out on the last trip. We set a speed record between the United States and Tinian, which is 9 days. Now, I understand it's still in existence. We took the first atomic of Tinian. And the first time in the history of the Navy, a captain became marshal for loss of a ship. It hasn't happened before or since. And the Navy Department told us, guys, we spent more time in the Cape Cod life jacket and survived. Nobody done any longer. And there's more men lost on that ship, which is 860, in other words, in wartime. That's the biggest loss they ever had. People questioned it was the Arizona. The Arizona was 2-3 hours before the war. And they had 1227. We were second. Okay. I was sleeping right near this 8-inch gun. And I had the 48 watch up on the bow. At 4 o'clock in the morning, I lay down up there. We take a Navy blanket and fold it in two and make a little sleeping bag out of it. That was the second night I slept up there. We take our shoes and our pillow, make our shoes and our clothes, and make a pillow out of it. And that's where I was sleeping. I lay down at 10 minutes to 12. The ship blew up at 10 after. I was asleep because I was flying through the air. Anyhow, the man had watch up there. I thought he was gone, but he survived too. In other words, they blew a bomb off. And this here, should go over a little further. What is here, why the ship blew up so bad? Because it was storage for the 8-inch powder room and the aviation gasoline area, sinks, because we had two seaplanes aboard. So I think, my opinion, that's why the ship sank so quick. There's that blew a hole on the bottom of it.
Tell them how you got off the ship.
Oh, well, I went in the air and I couldn't find my clothes. So me and 8, 10, 12 of us went aft for general quarters. It's on the other side. And this here was all the gulf with flames. So we couldn't go any forward, so we went aft again. And by that time, the ship was lifting pretty good. And some guy had a knife, and he cut down these life jackets right here. We cut down three or four of them. By that time, the ship was really lifting, and somebody had a knife to cut down canvas bags of life jackets. I was lucky I got one. Time I got on, everybody asked me, where was you on the ship when you jumped off the ship? I didn't jump off the ship. The ship left me. When it went down, I swam away. In other words, the bow went down first. So I was lucky. There was very little suction this way. I talked to survivors real close. And a little bit I seen, there was, sometimes the moon would come out a little bit. The cable that goes outside the ship, there was men hanging on it just like flies. They were falling off of it, or slipping off it, or going down with it. But we had 4 18-foot screws, and they were still turning when it was going down. So I hope that answers your question.
Well, again, we are very lucky to have you and to have Kim and your son David here. So a round of applause for lucky to have you, along with we are lucky to have our sponsors. And this doesn't happen without our sponsors. And so I'd like to read you this full page list with the idea is this. Please, the holiday season is coming up. Stop in these places. Find people that are with these organizations and say thank you. Not only for your education that you got tonight, but for the kids. Central Wisconsin. And that's amazing that we can provide these opportunities outside our textbooks.
I would sit while he reads this list. Seriously, sit down. I said everybody needs to sit down because you're an expensive date. I said, you're an expensive date.
Oh, yeah.
Berg Sales, Covantage Credit Union, Wausau Noon Optimist Club, Edgar Lyons, Woodtrust Bell Foundation, Reuter Ware, Advantage Community Bank, Edgar and Wausau, Judd S. Alexander Foundation, Edgar Legion, Edgar VFW, the Wausau Legion, Montgomery Plant, Dudley Post 10, Bain Insurance, Abbey Bank, Edgar Area Educational Foundation, Disabled American Veterans Organization, UMR of Wausau, Marathon County Public Library System, ELM of Edgar, University of Wisconsin Stevens Point at Wausau, Wisconsin Public Radio, First Impressions, NWA, Northwestern Wisconsin Associates, Fenwood Lions, Godorzy, In Memory of Daniel J. Merkus, Heil Ginseng, Midwest Dental, Yankee Bookstore, Dan Service Plus, Kathy Winters, Damchek and Varlene Law, John and Carrie Lisinski, MPNC, CCT Controlled Concepts Technology, Edgar Sport and Spine, Young's Pharmacy, Ascension Medical Group, Badger Basket, Dale and Amy Dahlke, Cloverbelt Credit Union, People's State Bank, Research Fuels, Edgar IGA, WREA, Wisconsin Retired Educators Association, Vietnam Veterans of America, Toyota of Wausau, Jefferson Street Inn, Merkel Foundation, Marathon Cheese Corporation, Edgar PTO, Rebecca Larson, Edgar FFA, Hugum Law Firm, Edgar Area JCs, the Dirks Group, David and Renee Friedel, Dudley Foundation, B.A. and Esther Greenheck Foundation, the Community Foundation of North Central Wisconsin Beyond Pencils and Crayons, the Wausau School District, and the Edgar School District. A round of applause for our sponsors.